Hey everyone, it's Justin again. So I'm visiting my aunt and younger cousin in a few days, and I wanted to bring my cousin a treat. There's a health food store by my house that sells dried fruit, and I know my cousin loves this stuff. I told my aunt I would pick some up for him and bring it with me. Now, the dried fruit is sold by the pound, and it costs $10 per pound. I'd like to spend more than $15, but I also want to stay within a $20 budget. This means that I have two inequalities that I'm trying to fulfill at the same time, which makes this a type of compound inequality. You'll get a chance to help me figure out how many pounds of dried fruit to buy in your PDF after this video, but for now, let's get started with the lesson. We'll go over the details of compound inequalities, and I'll work through two example problems with you. Let's get into it! Let me show you how this all works. You'll see two types of compound inequalities in this lesson. One type is when there's the word and between two inequalities. This word and tells us that any solutions must be true in both inequalities. Using a number line will be very useful here so we can visualize what all the solutions are. We can plot the first inequality and the second inequality on the same number line. In this example, where do you think the solution to the compound inequality is? What section on the number line fulfills both inequalities? Well, at the number 2, only one of the inequalities holds true, which we can see because of the open circle. And the same thing happens at the number 8. But the overlap is between 2 and 8. Where both inequalities had their lines. When we only include the section that does work in both inequalities, we're left with this. Seeing this visually on a number line can also help me to see that there might be an alternative way to write this solution as an inequality, rather than just using the word and. If we flip this inequality around, remembering to flip the inequality symbol, and merge these two inequalities together, we can read this as x is between 2 and 8. It's still a compound inequality, but we're able to write it as one statement. This is a nice, shorter way to write the inequality rather than using the word and. And don't forget about another way we've learned to write this, interval notation. Notice that this interval notation doesn't have an infinity symbol, which is something we haven't really seen before. You'll see this happen when we actually have two endpoints and aren't using an arrow in our number line representation. This interval notation says that our solutions are all the numbers from 2 to 8, but not including 2 or 8. Then there's the compound inequality containing the word or between two inequalities. When we see the word or, it means that solutions only have to be true in one of the inequalities. So a number that could be true in the first or the second inequality, but if any particular numbers work in both, that's still fine too. Just like with compound inequalities containing the word and, this can also be helpful to visualize on a number line. We can graph the first inequality and then graph the second inequality on the same number line. Now, remembering that or means only one of the inequalities has to be true, where do you think our solutions are this time? Are you thinking of two different sections where the solutions will be? Since only one of the inequalities has to hold true, our solutions will be at and to the left of negative 3, but also to the right of positive 2. Since that is exactly what we have drawn on this number line for this example, we don't need to erase anything like we did earlier when we were working with the word and. And since we don't need to erase anything on our number line, there wouldn't be any reason to alter the inequalities we have written above either. The next question is, how do we represent this using interval notation? Well, there is a handy math symbol that looks like a U shape. It technically means the union of. This symbol allows us to put two interval notations together to fully represent the sections containing all of the solutions. The solutions here are all numbers less than negative 3 or equal to negative 3, but also any numbers greater than 2. And there we have it, the two types of compound inequalities you can encounter using and or, and the different ways to express those compound inequalities, including inequality notation, on a number line, and interval notation. Now that we know that a compound inequality is an inequality that uses and or to combine two simpler inequalities, and we know that we can write them in the same ways we're used to, let's try solving a few. You're going to see here that we're really just continuing to use all the same inequality solving skills that we already have. Let me show you what I mean. This example says to solve the compound inequality and show the solutions using the three methods we've learned: inequality notation, a number line, and interval notation. Then we are given two inequalities below with the word and combining them. What we need to do is solve both inequalities separately, and then place our solutions on a number line to help us visualize where the solutions really are. It's important for you to give this a try on your own, so pause the video now and see how far you can get without me. Go ahead and check your work with mine. Next, I just brought everything together so I'd have it organized. Then I can focus on visualizing these individual solutions on a number line. We can graph that x is greater than 2, and then on the same number line, we can graph that x is greater than or equal to 7. Remember that our compound inequality used the word and. So does that mean I'm looking for solutions that work in both inequalities? Or is it okay if it only works in one of them? Yeah, the solutions to the compound inequality need to work in both individual inequalities. So where are both inequalities true? Where are both of them included on the number line? 7 works in both of them, and so does anything larger than 7. We can either do a little erasing or draw a new number line to show the solutions for the compound inequality. Since the solutions will be where the overlap is, we are left with this. It's also important to take this number line visual and reflect on whether or not the inequality notation we have here is really the most efficient way to write our final solution. Now that we have this number line to help us visualize what this means, how would you write the inequality for it? This x is greater than 2 part just isn't needed, because it doesn't add in any new solutions, but really just repeats what we already know. If it's 7 or bigger, then it has to be greater than 2. Sometimes things like this happen with a compound inequality, and it's important to write your solutions as simply as possible. Can you think of a shorter way to write this as an inequality without any redundancies or repeating the same information? Yeah, x is greater than or equal to 7 covers all the answers that worked in both of these, so that is all we need. All right, now that we have our answer in inequality notation, and also on a number line, we just need to represent the same answer in interval notation. What is the interval notation that represents the same solutions? That's right, 7 to infinity with a bracket next to the 7 to show that 7 is included as well. And now we have everything we needed to solve this problem. Let's do one more. This example again says to solve the compound inequality and show the solutions using inequality notation, a number line, and interval notation. Then we're given two inequalities below with the word or combining them. We need to solve both inequalities separately and then place their solutions on a number line to help us visualize where the solutions to the compound inequality are. Pause the video here and try this by yourself. Go ahead and check your work with mine. Then I like to line everything back up so there's no confusion with what I have so far. Now let's get the number line made too, just to verify that the way this inequality notation is written is really the best option. This number line is showing us that numbers smaller than 2 and numbers bigger than 4 are solutions, but let's make sure this is really what we want. Does the word or in the compound inequality tell us that both individual inequalities need to be true, or is just one enough? The word or in the compound inequality tells us that only one inequality has to hold true for the number to be a valid answer. So, is there any particular section on the number line that we need to erase because it's just saying the same thing twice, or should it be included? We don't have to erase any of the arrows we drew. There were no redundancies or repetitions of the same information. And that means this inequality works just fine. And since there are two separate sections on the number line included in our answer, how can we represent this in interval notation? We get to use a union symbol when writing interval notation. And now we have all the parts of our answer. Compound inequalities may seem strange and tedious at first, but if you think of the process in smaller sections, it might be helpful for you. You need to solve for the variable in each inequality, then graph both inequalities on a number line, and do any erasing or adjusting based on the and or statement. Then decide if there is a simpler way to write that compound inequality you got that's maybe more efficient or gets rid of any unnecessary repetition, and finally, write the interval notation. It can take some practice to really get comfortable working with compound inequalities, which is why there are some extra practice problems for you to work through in your PDF before you start the practice game. You'll want to make sure you're really prepared for the next lesson, because you're going to learn about two things that can happen with compound inequalities where the solutions are a little more out of the ordinary. I know, intriguing, right? Anyways, thanks for joining me today, and I will see you next time.